Hello and welcome to the BIMstorm introductory webinar for the BIMstorm Big BIM Bang, October 31st, 2011. Thanks for joining us. Today's webinar, we have two themes. We have a BIMstorm focused on health and a BIMstorm focused on education. With us today are representatives from Kaiser Permanente, the Foundation for California Community Colleges, and Build LACCD, and we will be presenting the projects that are going to be part of today, the BIMstorm this year. This is the order of the presentation today. Just so everybody that's online is aware, we will be taking questions through the chat box in the GoToWebinar interface. You can actually type in your questions and we'll take them at the very end of the webinar. If we don't get around to everybody's questions, we will respond by email. One concept in a lot of these BIMstorms is there's a lot of material and a lot of things going on, but we want to focus on how do we keep things as simple as possible and how do we enhance collaboration and communication between teams and owners. Standards and interoperability are critical to all of what we do, just like the internet that exploded because of the way that standards work and allow you to work on many different tools and platforms and supports many different processes and keeps things simple and actually creates even a support mechanism for revolutions. Communication between teams is critical, and we're trying to enhance that in the building industry, and that's what we've been focusing on with BIMstorm. This is a poster from the first BIMstorm, BIMstorm LA, in 2008, which won several awards in the industry. And a lot of participants have been involved in BIMstorms over the years. This is Penn State and the LA BIMstorm collaborating in real time with teams from around the world. We had about 140 teams from around the world collaborating on this BIMstorm. A BIMstorm is essentially a workshop, a charrette, where you can work with teams either in real time through the internet or in the room together, or a hybrid approach, and that's what this year's BIMstorm really is all about. The BIMstorm is sponsored by Onuma Inc. with co-sponsors at the platinum level from Balfour Beatty Construction, who has been involved in very heavily in the previous BIMstorms and will be again this year, so we want to thank all of our sponsors. At the gold level, we have the EcoBuild America conference, which is happening in December in Washington, D.C., and we will be at EcoBuild for 2 days in the BIMstorm Theater, working live sessions with all the teams. Gary Technologies is also a gold sponsor. At the silver level, we have Buxun Power with building sensors and control systems. Infocom International, representing different vendors of equipment using building information modeling standards to support the building industry. Broadus and Associates, who has been involved actually with Onuma Inc. on several projects focusing on COBE, Construction Operation Building Information Exchange, at the bronze level, and also Trelligence, who has a great tool for planning and programming, connecting it to other tools like IES and Revit and other BIM applications. So we want to thank all of our sponsors for supporting the BIMstorm. The reason we are able to make the BIMstorm free to participate in is because of the support of the sponsors. So we really encourage everybody to jump in. There's no entry fee or anything. It's really about opening things up and letting people collaborate. We're really excited to announce this year a new technology that's going to be added to the BIMstorm. We've been using the Onuma system for many years, but we as a model server in the cloud, and Gary Technologies has just recently announced their GTX tool, which is a web-based server in the cloud that can take in many different BIM formats, full-blown Revit models and IFC models and Rhino models. So we will be combining the two systems to help connect the teams together in this year's BIMstorm. So the Onuma system is a web-based tool for collaboration. We'll be using that as one platform to kind of connect the teams together as we have in different BIMstorms. It's intentionally kept very lightweight to be able to run on the internet, and we can import and export many different models from that. It works in multiple stages of the design process, all the way from early design to maintenance and operations. GTX is the new tool that I mentioned earlier from Gary Technologies. It's good for data management, 3D and metadata mashups, analytics and data mining, and it will be included free for all BIMStorm participants, and it's free until February of 2011. So it's really exciting to have Gary Technologies and GTX jumping into the BIMStorm and being one of the sponsors to help us connect the dots between the different tools. Trelligence Affinity is another sponsor, and here are some of the things that they do with their tool, connecting it to many different other applications as well, and they actually have a connection back to Onuma system as well through a BIM XML and IFC formats. So what's this BIMStorm all about? There's the healthcare focus and also the education focus. If you look at the full life cycle of many different of facilities, you go from early planning all the way to maintenance and operations. One of the projects from the California Community College, the Foundation for California Community Colleges, is the integration of facility data, the Fusion system, with GIS data, and the Onuma system with BIM data. Part of that will be the MiraCosta Master Plan. It's a community college in Oceanside that is just getting completed in draft format, and we're going to have access to the information from that. We have LACCD Mission College under construction, a building there that will be taken from BIM into COBE. Kaiser Permanente, Gwinnett project, and the Glen Lake project, which we will explain later. These are projects, the Gwinnett project's under construction, and the Glen Lake project is in design. And there's three MiraCosta projects that are part of the master plan, new buildings. And the intent here is to allow teams to jump in at any part of the process that they're interested in working with. We will have access to a lot of these models. We'll be designing some projects from the beginning, working with existing data, so you really have an opportunity to showcase what you're able to do and to be able to work with these projects. The intent is you don't really, obviously in a very short time period, we're not expecting a full-blown project kind of an approach. You really can focus in on the parts that you want or expand out to as much as you want, and also encourage collaboration with other BIMStorm teams. That's really the goal of the BIMStorm, is to even collaborate across. And even though this is a mixture of two project types, healthcare and education, there's a lot of similarities between what these owners are looking for, including outside of just healthcare and education. We're seeing very similar patterns of what's happening in the industry. For example, a lot of owners are requiring BIM, but now what happens when you deliver a BIM to an owner? What are they going to do with that BIM file to take it into operations and maintenance? And that's what LACCD is doing, and also the BIM Healthcare Consortium, which Kaiser is part of, has been very focused on very much as well too. So next, I'd like to have Kaiser Permanente present a little bit about what they're doing. We'll keep this kind of interactive, but we have Stephen Cox, manager Facilities Design and Construction, Alexander Hare, Senior Project Manager, and Jiajun Lin from the National Facility Services Facilities Planning Group. So welcome to all of you. Can you introduce yourselves briefly?
Sure, I'm Steve Cox. I'm the manager of facilities design and construction in Kaiser Permanente's Georgia region.
I'm Alex Herr. I'm the senior project manager. I'm in charge of the Gwinnett Comprehensive Medical Center project that we'll be talking about today.
This is Jiajun Lin. I'm with National Facility Services, Kaiser Permanente, and the Facilities Planning Group.
Okay, thank you. So first, we'd like to go briefly over the Gwinnett project. Maybe you guys can review that.
Yeah, come on, I can talk about that. Great. For everybody real quick. It is currently under construction. We are scheduled to get our Certificate of Occupancy and Substantial Completion on January 13th of 2012. That being said, right now we're wrapping up the exterior cladding work, and we are moving into, or we've been working on the interiors of the building with prime paint, casework, ceiling grid and tile, overhead inspections. In the next couple of weeks, we should be getting into the flooring and really heavy duty on the finishes. The project is a two-phase project. The new building is 66,000 square feet, and the existing building, we have renovations of about 19,000 square feet that will start after the new building is opened. Construction value is around $21 million, and the total budget for Kaiser on the project is approximately $52 million. The big thing that we're looking for or hoping to get out of this event is a lot of the transition from the GC's 3D model and the coordination we did between architecture and the MEP subcontractors, and moving that into the facilities management world so that the building end users, our engineering staff, have the ability to use all the information that we have on all the equipment from initial coordination through the commissioning of the systems. We are using Vela Field Manager on the project for our commissioning activities as well, and the transition of that data back into the Navisworks model.
Okay, great. So a few questions and comments on this project. From what I understand, there's a Revit model, there's SketchUp models, there's other models available, as well as Navisworks models, which will be made available to the teams that want to participate. And since this project is in construction, the interest is in what can we do with this data as we go into operations and maintenance. So obviously there's a lot of rich data in the models, and this is a great opportunity for teams that want to actually look at this live model that's already under construction and see what else can be done with it. There's we also noticed there in the program requirements, there's information about performance and equipment, and even the original architectural design data, the program requirements. So some teams, if they want to look at kind of deconstructing what were the requirements, now what does the result look like? So it's pretty open. And so as this project's actually happening for Kaiser in the BIMstorm, we're able to kind of go in and out of the data that will be shared with the teams to be able to work with this project.
Timon, the only other thing I might add is that we are trying to go for a LEED Silver certification. And at this time, we believe we have 53 out of 50 points for that certification. We've made our initial submittal to USGBC for the design side, and we're currently pulling all the information for the construction side.
Great. Well, thank you for submitting this project, and we're really excited to have an actual project in the BIMstorm that's under construction. It's great that you're willing to share all the data with the BIMstorm teams and the industry, and we hope we can get some interesting results as we go through these projects. Okay, so we have the Revit model, the SketchUp model, and here's the actual construction site that's happening right now. And next, we'd like to talk a little bit about the Glen Lake Comprehensive Medical Center and Ambulatory Project.
All right, well, I'm going to talk about that. This is Steve Cox. We have none of that on this project. This project is very early in the design process. Matter of fact, we're just going into schematic design as we speak now. But the project is very similar to the Gwinnett project, where it's an addition to an existing building. The existing building is about 120,000 square feet, and the proposed addition is about 120,000 square feet. So we're doubling the campus size here with the addition of a large parking structure in addition to an existing parking structure on the site. The project is a high-end, high acuity, high-end specialty MOB, along with an ambulatory surgery center and procedure area. The project is on a piece of land that we own. It's about, I think it's a little under 18 acres that we own. And it is scheduled for completion, like all of our projects here, in a very aggressive schedule of the end of 2013 to 2014, to the very early parts of 2014. So we are currently designing the project with the Smith Group out of Washington, D.C. We do have a general contractor on board. It's McCarthy out of St. Louis. We hope to break ground sometime early next year. We actually took the unique part of this is the design package that we put out, and in the construction package we put out, we were able to take a lot of our BIM learnings from Gwinnett and another project. Gwinnett has a sister project called Town Park, and incorporate those in, and from an owner's perspective, really specify what we wanted to see in a BIM product. And I think that was kind of unique to most of the architectural firms that we had. They hadn't really seen too many owners specifying what they wanted to see in BIM, and we got a very, very competitive process for architectural design, and we're very happy to be working with the Smith Group, and they are very, very engaged with the BIM production.
Great. Well, thanks for outlining that, and I think this is actually an interesting point in the project that I'm hoping that a lot of teams can jump in and test out different ideas with the actual program that's being developed here as well. This is one thing that's interesting about the BIM storms that we set up. We intentionally pull them away from being involved in the actual contracting of the project, and allows us to test different ideas out. So we even call some of these things train wrecks. We want to see what potential problems there might be or opportunities there are. And having actual data like this allows us to kind of interact with you guys, with the owners here on this project. So we're happy to have the Glen Lake project involved here. Did we talk about the team that's currently involved with Gwinnett? I don't think it was mentioned. If you can.
No, come on. I'm sorry. I missed that. This is Alex again. The architect of record is HKS out of Atlanta, and the MEP firm is Perry Crabb and Associates out of Atlanta. The general contractor is Skanska, and they're doing it out of their Atlanta office as well.
Great. Thank you very much. And we will be creating a list with more detail that's going to be shared with everybody next week about this. Today's webinar is kind of a high-level overview, but we will be giving more data, including access to how you'd get to these models. So anything else from the Kaiser Permanente team? Maybe, Jiajun, can you say a few words about BIM Healthcare Consortium?
Yes, Mo, thank you. The Healthcare BIM Consortium, HBC, has been created by healthcare owners in collaboration with software vendors, designers, and builders to seek solutions for interoperability to support facility lifecycle management. Currently, the owners group includes Kaiser Permanente, Department of Defense Military Health, DOD, Department of Veterans Affairs, VA, and Sutter Health, and recently we also had University of Texas join the group. The HPC has five core focus areas that are being addressed in a collaborative effort, and they are automate a program for design, validation, and design submittal. So the idea is the input data flow handover for design team, and other ones are automate room equipment, validation that's also in the early phase input data flow phase. We also have three other tracks, optimize the benefits of BIM during execution of design to ensure successful project construction, automate data population of computerized maintenance management software, CMMS system, FAFM. So this will be on the output data flow. And the automated data population for medical equipment, furniture inventory, and maintenance systems. We look forward to sharing the lessons learned from this year's BIM storm in the next HDC meeting, which will be in late January 2012, be held in Dallas, Texas. For details regarding the next meeting, you should see the HPC website that's hosted by Building Smart Alliance. So we're very, very excited to be part of this BIM storm, and we look forward to a very interesting result.
Great. Thank you, Jiajun. And actually, that goes back to the theme that I started with earlier. The BIM Healthcare Consortium is really looking at how data flows from different parts of the process. And it's the exact same themes that are happening with a lot of the other owners. And the fact that the BIM Healthcare Consortium actually covers a lot of healthcare owners, I believe it was stated it's close to 50% of all healthcare facilities in the U.S. It's interesting to see this collaboration happening. And a lot of other vendors and specialists from the industry have been involved in all of those meetings, including Onuma Inc. and Broadus. We have been at those as well. So it's interesting to see the evolution of those discussions that have been happening for the last year and a half. We have a question coming in. Can you please provide some examples of the BIM information that will be used in FM? Okay, maybe we could cover that later on, but that's some of the work that's happening with the LACCD College, the Mission College COBE, Construction Operation Building Information Exchange, which is an international standard for managing how facility management data flows from BIM for construction into facility management. So we want to see how that data can be used, like for example, in the Gwinnett project, we know that Vela is involved with the commissioning of the building. So how does commissioning data flow into facility management, or the same data that's coming from the BIM going into commissioning and facility management? We could cover more of that as we go through the BIM storms process next week when we start getting into more details. We don't have enough time today to go into all the details, obviously, so we'd like to kind of move on here to our next presenter. John Roach, Executive Director of Technology Services from the Foundation for California Community Colleges. John, welcome to the BIM Storm.
Thanks, come on. The foundation is the official auxiliary to the statewide chancellor's office, and in that capacity, the foundation is involved in a lot of programs that support the chancellor's office directly or the individual districts. And we're a large higher ed system. We have 72 districts spread throughout California with 71 million square feet of building space and nearly 3 million students a year. And all of those districts and campuses are using our facility maintenance program, Fusion, to collaborate with the chancellor's office on annual reporting. Next slide. Come on.
Yes, hold on a second. For some reason, it's not
okay.
Advancing here. What's going on? Let's try this. For some reason, it got stuck.
There
Okay.
we go.
All right. Go ahead.
And the slide that was just up there for a moment listed the 16 districts that had all contributed money to the original development of the Fusion system. Fusion is operated and maintained by my team here at the foundation, but it's actually owned by the districts. It was the vision of Fred Harris, the assistant vice chancellor at the chancellor's office for facilities and finance, and those 16 districts that we had up on the screen, that saw the need for integrating the information in Fusion to streamline and standardize the exchange of information dealing with the facilities. Next. The basic workflow in the Fusion system is shown here in the diagram, starting with the top box here in space inventory. The districts have obligations to annually submit space inventory information explaining what space has been added, what space has been removed, and how those spaces are being used down to the room level. The second box at about 3 o'clock deals with the facility condition assessment. We have a team of assessors that travel the state full-time and visit each campus, walking each building approximately once every 3 years, giving regular information, collecting information about the condition of the systems making up those buildings. The chancellor's office then provides annual updates for enrollment forecasts. And the districts then take those enrollment forecasts and allocate them out to their individual campuses and add additional forecasts for out years. And with those three basic building blocks, the space inventory telling us what spaces we have and how it's being used, the condition of the space, and the enrollment forecast, the districts then have the basic building blocks for developing their capital construction plans. And as those capital plans are approved by the chancellor's office and then funded, active projects move into the project module of Fusion, and as they're built out and the claims, financial reimbursement claims are processed, that project moves back into the space inventory and the cycle continues. If you think of this workflow in the context of the facility asset management lifecycle, next slide, come on, spanning from master planning to maintenance, job ticketing, space scheduling, energy management, Fusion sits about in the middle. Next slide. And Fred Harris and I have long had an interest of finding ever new ways to share the core information that's in Fusion, but make it available to the districts and their contractors for a much wider array of facility projects than just what goes on within the Fusion module itself. And we've been successful in that, and in bits and pieces over the years in developing GIS resources, architectural drawings database, and some other tools. But rather than focus on building new modules in Fusion, next slide, please, we're particularly interested in developing flexible means of being able to trade data back and forth using web services so that the core information in Fusion can be made available to other vendors working with the districts and be linked into other tools so that we can add these features while letting all the various teams that are involved maintain their own sets of data. So we each maintain our own sets of data, and then but we collaborate by sharing it through web services. Specifically, ideally, we do it as we're doing it in the Enuma system. Next slide. And it was with this idea in mind, this desire to find flexible ways to exchange data between several different systems, that we went out looking for a platform to collaborate with. And it was through pilot work that was done at San Joaquin Delta College in Stockton that I was introduced to Kimon and the Enuma system. And since that time, we've found, because of the standards approach, the lightweight web-based approach, that it's the ideal tool for being able to link into these tools. And following the preliminary pilot work that was done at Delta College, we've since moved on to doing a larger demonstration project with six districts. And we've moved on since then to being able to work with individual districts on larger focused projects dealing on a range of projects from master planning through to maintenance, ticketing, sensor and energy reading, and so on. I'm very excited about college district projects being involved in the BIM Storm, because it gives a great opportunity for contractors that are working with the colleges or potential new contractors to get a sense of what the community college work scope is, and it gives our districts a chance to hear some fresh and new ideas and to see how this collaborative approach and data sharing can help them save money and get more done with the limited budget we have to maintain our facilities. If there's any questions, otherwise we can go back to you. Come on.
Thanks, John. And yeah, one point we'd like to make about what's happening with the Foundation for California Community Colleges is it really is the BIM storms that we've been doing over the years essentially have transformed into what's really going on at the Foundation for California Community Colleges. So the ability to collaborate across many different tools using web services. So as John described, Fusion, and they also have the GIS system, and the Enuma system is one of the tools that's connecting to those three. But really the intent is we're actively looking for other tools out there that can connect to the system and add more value. For example, energy, building automation systems and control systems and other future systems like CMMS systems, classroom scheduling, a lot of different tools that kind of plug and play just like the internet works today. And then working through other open standards connections to the other desktop BIM applications like Revit. It's a very powerful kind of concept to use the right tool for the right thing that you're trying to do. So if you're trying to manage the entire state of California, what really happened with the Fusion system is essentially we have the entire 71 million square feet, all 5,000 buildings in BIM basically from the Fusion data at varying levels of detail. So you could literally go in to a campus, pull down a BIM as an IFC format, or pull it into Revit, or pull it into SketchUp, or pull it into other tools, and continue to work with the data that is coming from the state. So this is millions of data points, because every single building has data about the space name and the condition of the space, and it's intentionally kept this lightweight format so we can get to it in real time. And that's been the foundation for a lot of the BIM Storm work, is how do we collaborate with complex data across many different a portfolio of projects and be able to manage it down to the building level like we were doing with the Fusion system. So here's a campus, and you'll be seeing more of this as we go along in the BIM Storm, of how this type of process can support bringing in, for example, this model came from a CAD or a BIM that was as built, and now we bring it into the system to keep it kind of lightweight, to be able to look at in real time what's my building doing, or connecting it to energy systems. Actually, this is happening right now at a community, Glendale Community College, is connecting building automation systems and sensors to the Fusion data. So this is Energol, who is one of the sponsors of the BIMstorm, that's implementing their tool in various places, and connecting also to VROC to show temperature. So there's a lot of, it's really kind of a mashup of different tools that in the past were locked into hardware, whereas now we're able to connect and see different applications kind of coming together. So next, we'd like to introduce briefly the MiraCosta project. And John, you can jump in on this as well. I'll be opening it up live in a second. But this project is one of the districts in California. It's in the Fusion system as well. There's a master plan that was recently completed in draft format. It's almost complete, but it's in draft format. We're going to point the teams to this master plan. It has a lot of good rich data in the background that can be used for planning the projects. There have been several energy studies as well, audits for demand response and how to reduce energy use for the whole campus. So there's multiple different reports kind of coming together that we're absorbing into the BIMstorm and setting up the different planning scenarios. So for example, at MiraCosta, the red buildings here are part of the master plan of new projects that are going to come up as far as over the next several years, and they're tied back to the master plan. So that we'll show that live in a second here. Okay, next online, let's see, Tina Mashika from MPM Consultancy, supporting Build LA CCD program.
Hi, how are you?
Hi, Tina. Thanks for joining.
Thank you. Do you want to go to the next slide?
Sure.
So I've been working with Los Angeles Community College District on developing a COBE specification, and Painco, who is the design builder for the project that's up on the screen here, it's on the East Campus Complex at Mission College, has also been interested in what the college is doing, and we're basically trying to figure out how to take the information that we received during construction, the operations, manuals, the maintenance manuals, the warranty information, and put it into a format, a data format, that you can transfer it automatically into SAP. So Enuma has been working with us on developing a specification. We're trying to keep it pretty simple. The goal is to take actual information that's already required to be delivered in the written format and just have them move it into an electronic format. As you can see, this building is rather complex. It's a lab building, so there's a lot of equipment that's in it. So it's a great example of, you know, different types of items that will need to be maintained. The other thing that we've been looking at is, since we know the Fusion project is underway, is how do we take some of that information and hook it back into Fusion so that the client can manage their assets down the line in a logical manner. So uploading the maintenance information into their maintenance management system, which is SAP, and then taking that information, looking at the life cycle of the product, and, you know, communicating with the community college on how to or what needs to be done so that they're just smarter and they're working more efficiently across the line. So the campus, these campus complexes is about 50% complete. Enuma has completed this, well, I guess the spec is about 95% complete. We're going to start testing it, and I believe that's what we're going to release some of this information during the BIMstorm so that the different project teams can utilize what we've done and, you know, see if it works. And then we can also take a look at it and see how everything comes together. So there's a lot of parties involved here, the architects, the engineers, the builder, the sub-consultants, manufacturers. So it'll be interesting to see how this all turns out.
Great. Thanks, Tina. I could add a few more words about this. This project is very interesting because obviously there's a highly detailed model prepared by Panka for the construction of the building. From a facility management point of view, the data is the same that you need for the life cycle, but it's very specific parts of the model. We don't need every single element in this model that you see on screen during facilities management. So what we worked on with LACCD and with Tina was to identify specifically in the spec what is needed from the model. And some of it could be very simple data about the piece of equipment. We might not need all the ducts, but we need the air handling units, for example, and the pumps, and the maintenance information, the warranty information, and replacement parts. So it's very specific thing. It's BIM data at a different level of detail. And that's a very important concept for the building industry to understand, because a lot of these models are getting delivered to owners, and the owners really, I mean, they're great for construction, but they don't support facility management. So how do you break this data back down into a different format? It's not necessarily the more data you have, the better. It's really the appropriate level of detail for what you're trying to do throughout the whole project. So we're very excited to have access to this model in the BIM Storm from LACCD. Before we go on, there was a couple of questions I saw just come online. Going back to the Fusion system, question for the Fusion system, is it available for other potential buyers, parties? Also, is the visualization of data 3D real-time or 2D real-time? I could start answering the question. Maybe, John, you could jump in a little bit, but the Fusion system is owned by the state of California, the Foundation for California Community Colleges, by all the districts. It's basically, and that's a key differentiator here, is that they've built a system that's open and available to everybody in the districts. It's connected to what we showed earlier in the diagram of the Onuma system and the GIS and everything else. In other owners' cases, we've seen. A similar kind of system set up, either embedded in the tools or also connecting through web services. John, do you want to elaborate a little bit on that, about ownership and how you get access to the Fusion system? How do the districts get to it, and how are we making it accessible for this BIM Storm?
Sure. The Fusion, as Kimon said, is owned by the districts. The districts that paid for it. I'm basically a steward on behalf of the districts and taking care of the Fusion system. It is built currently specific to the needs and the planning cycles and forms and schedules that are needed in the community college system. There is an opportunity for being able to build in configurability, and I would need a large institutional partner to help in doing that, and of course I'd have to work with my owners to talk about what interest is there. But in terms of access for the BIM Storm, access to the Fusion data is accessible through Onuma itself, and also any of the participants in the BIM Storm can contact us, and we can give you visitor access to the Fusion data specific for the BIM Storm project. I'll work with the individual district representatives at LA and MiraCosta and other campuses to make sure the local facility director approves that, but that's mostly a formality in this case. So the data will be fully available, and people will be able to explore the layout of the Fusion system, how it works, compare the data that's in the Fusion application itself to what we port over through web services into the Onuma system.
Great. Thanks, John. And yeah, the one part of this that actually connects to what Tina was talking about earlier, in Tina's case for LACCD, it's about one building that is part of the LACCD, Los Angeles Community College District, which is part of the entire state of California Community Colleges. So one out of, say, 5,000 buildings. In the Fusion system, there's specific data that's of interest from that BIM that's under construction now, that talks more about spaces and square footages and location and condition, and having a consistent database. And that's one very important part, theme for all these BIM Storms and a lot of these owners, is how do we consistently get data from all of our facilities that can be rolled up to a portfolio level. And that's not possible unless you have consistent naming and numbering. It's as simple as that, actually. We have to have consistent naming and numbering at a very basic level. If we can't name buildings and number buildings and name spaces and number spaces in a consistent way, it's impossible to say, well, what's inside that? So that's the lowest level of detail BIM in this BIM Storm, is really, let's keep data consistent. And that's already been done a lot of times in these systems. Okay, we have a couple more questions about the visualization of data, 3D real-time or 2D real-time. In the BIM Storm, there's going to be real-time visualization as well as non-real-time visualization. It's a hybrid approach. So when you're in the Fusion system, for example, it's actually real-time data coming in. You're seeing buildings and locations of buildings and conditions of buildings, or even live sensors that's saying, here's a temperature of a space in the Glendale College. That's all happening in real time. When you go offline into other desktop applications to do the more detailed BIM work, you're obviously not connected live to the systems, but you're using the same data. So we're going to go through a lot of those workflows to explain what the intent is here. Okay. Question for Kaiser Permanente. If Kaiser Permanente's goal is to link the associated data specific to an element in the model, where will that applicable data be housed? How will you all protect the data? In the future, how will applicable data be made available to the FMO personnel immediately in the building while servicing the element? All very important questions, and I'll let Kaiser jump in as well, but how does data get shared or not shared, and who has access to it? Obviously, when you get into projects and get into detailed data, there's ways of kind of deciding who gets access to what information, not only to make it simpler for that person, but also from a security point of view. In the BIMstorm, we're gonna selectively decide what data from the project is going to be shared with the teams. That's the actual opportunity here, is that these owners have agreed to share this data with teams that sign up to be part of the BIMstorm. Does the Kaiser team have anything else to add to that about sharing of information and data?
Come on, this is Alex. I guess the only thing I'd say is, so far we've been pretty open. I think we've gotten you guys most everything. Where we go in the future, we're still investigating that and trying to figure out where we're going to go with our systems in general.
Right. And hopefully this will help spur some discussions about how that might be structured. And I think this is a consistent theme with a lot of owners of do we lock everything down or how do we share? And obviously when you start working with consultants, you have to share part of it. Even Homeland Security, for example, Homeland Security project, if you work with a consultant, you have to be able to share that, but at the same time, you want to be aware of the security and what needs to be shared and not only from a security perspective, but also to make it relevant to that person that's interacting with the data. Okay, a couple more questions about that. What about lab equipment? What information is being managed? I'm not sure if that's about Kaiser or about the LACCD project, but maybe it's about COBE, I think. What information is being managed? It depends on each owner. To what level of detail they want to manage information. It's not, and in the spec we've identified what parts of the equipment are of interest to LACCD, for example, which might be very different than what is of interest to Kaiser Permanente. If anybody wants to elaborate on that, please jump in.
I mean, if you look at it from a fume hood standpoint, you have to go through your testing sequences. So that testing data will be transferred into the SAP facilities management module so that they know when it's time to get recertified on it. So it's really whatever specific for each piece of equipment, what type of maintenance needs to be completed, and then it'll also be a repository of what the past maintenance on that piece of equipment has been. So, you know, this way the worker knows its history.
Okay, thanks, Tina. Next question is, which company provides the Energol system? Energol is created by a company called Buxun Power, and it's supported by a group here in the U.S. called IRIS Green Build. We could send information to everybody who needs information about this company in the communication later on. The issue of consistency may be the mantra of the presentation to reinforce the importance. Okay, that was more of a statement, I guess. It's the issue of consistency. Maybe the mantra, okay, to reinforce importance, okay. Could you please elaborate what are some of the data consistency file naming rules? It touches a lot of these projects that we're showing here. So in the COBE's case, we're using the Construction Operation Building Information Exchange Standard, and that is more about a structure of the data. Then the specification coming from LACCD is saying how do we name and number equipment and where does it land. So it's a combination of what the owner wants plus these open standards. And we'll get more into that in future discussions. So let's move on since we have about 15 minutes here. I wanted to show a little bit about, what's the result of a BIMstorm? Here's one example of what happened a few years ago for the Build Hospital Live in 2009. We started a BIMstorm in Oslo, Norway, and then brought it over to Washington, D.C., the initial concept was you have a starting point on the left of owner's requirements. You have a room requirements, programming requirements. You might have an existing building or a proposed building. You have to do space planning. You have to resolve the concept, and you have to go into details. And along the bottom, you see the green lines are showing the building smart connections, the open standards of the building industry. The goal was to see how can we communicate across many different tools, because no single application is going to be able to manage all the needs of a project. In that BIM storm, we broke it down very simply into 1, 2, and 3. Number one was we're going to do space planning, so here are programming requirements from an owner. The teams took the programming requirements from Excel into the Onima system, took it out to BIM, resolved it in the different BIM applications, and submitted it back. And then other teams also went into details of how do you lay out an operating room, for example. And some of the workflows were diagrammed here of how do you start from the programming requirements and track them into the design of the building, the blocking and stacking model, and how do those get communicated to the detailed design models as you start going into the design and construction. And how do you use a model server to support all this activity. So we're going to be sharing a lot of these diagrams for this BIM storm as well. It's going to be similar kind of workflows, and also the people that are involved in the process. So at each step of the workflow, there's different people involved and different interests in the type of data that's being shared. So, and then being able to do multiple iterations. So having the data accessible to run through multiple what-ifs as you're sketching the requirements, for example. And then bringing that data back from the desktop applications back into the server. Basically, as you're working the result, the detailed design in different tools, we want it to be submitted back to the owner in a consistent way so the owner can evaluate, do we have all the spaces that were required? Is the performance of the building as we had requested it to be? Is the temperature of the space correct? Are the pieces of equipment formatted in a way that can be consumed by the different facility management applications as was discussed earlier for COBE? And here are the results, the actual results of the teams that participate. This is a snapshot of many different teams using many different tools, collaborating at different levels of detail within a 3-day time span in Oslo. And we repeated this again when we brought it back to Washington, D.C. And next I'd like to go show a few things live, and we'll take a few more questions and answers, but I want to thank the sponsors again for supporting this year's BIM Storm. We still are looking for other sponsors. We are at the very beginning here, so if you'd like to jump in and sponsor, we'd really appreciate it. Otherwise, to participate is free, so we really encourage everybody to jump in. Okay, let's look at a few more questions here. Tools like this reinforcing standards. The standards are what, as we talked about earlier, the reason that we're able to connect the dots between many different types of tools, tools that do nothing but analyze results from a building, tools that are used for design and construction, tools that go into facility management, is the standards. These common standards are what allow things to kind of explode and connect, just like we talked about here. Facebook is supported by internet standards. The people that use Facebook don't have to understand the technical parts of why these standards exist and how they work. But without these standards, we would not have this explosion of communication. That's what we need in the building industry. Let's see, another question. Is there an equivalent commercial system to Fusion available to the market? We could respond to that separately, but there everything that you've seen here today, there are equivalent versions that can be used outside of the Fusion system as well, but I don't want to get into the details of that right now. We will respond later on that. Okay, so let's go into a couple things here. I'm going to go away from the PowerPoint for a second and explain a little bit, a few things. First, how do you sign up to be part of the BIM Storm? If you go to bimstorm.com, and in the center here is a link to BIM Storm Big BIM Bang. It's kind of a mouthful, which takes you to this page. The way that you can participate, you can either log in and watch these webinars, so you could just be observing what's going on, but we really would like you to sign up and jump in at whatever capacity you have. So it lists the projects we just talked about here. The sign up form takes you to a sign up where you list your name and what you're interested in, and then we'll by signing up here, this is signing into the BIM Storm, and we will send you information about how to participate The information will be coming out at the end of this week before the Monday start. So this is the form that you fill in, a very simple form saying who you are and what you're interested in, and then you'll get information of how to access all of this. The schedule's down here. The other webinars are just tentatively scheduled here. We might adjust the schedule, but we're scheduling one next week on November 7th as the official kind of start with all the data that we talked about for the projects. And then we'll be having weekly webinars to engage the teams and to go deeper into a lot of these workflows. We're going to try and record all these and post them here as well. So if you miss any of these, they'll be available here. We encourage you, we're going to be at EcoBuild. We usually have, every year we have a large 30 by 50 foot booth there, the BIMstorm booth. Teams assemble there, but you don't have to go to Washington, D.C. You can collaborate virtually online leading up to it. And we also have scheduled follow-up webinars after the live session at EcoBuild. So EcoBuild is going to be in December, and then we'll have sessions in January and February presenting to the owners of what the results were. So this is how you sign up. Very simple. We encourage you to just log in and click on the sign up page, and then you'll get information about how to participate in the BIMstorm. Okay, so to show a few things live here, we've in BIMstorms we have been using the Onuma system as the collaboration tool. It's kind of the way that we connect all these BIMs. Here's a view of Fusion system, the 5,000 buildings in California. Each dot is a campus, and you zoom in, you can keep on going down into a single campus. And what we're doing is we're focusing on MiraCosta, as I mentioned earlier. So this is a live view of the MiraCosta campus. And from here, you can export the new building. So you could say, okay, I want to see color code the buildings based on the master plan. Right now, the color coding you see right now is kind of the condition of the buildings, but now it's switching over to show me the master plan. The red buildings are the proposed buildings, and from here you can actually dive into the building and grab the program requirements from that building and continue to work with it in your tool or continue to manipulate it here in the Onuma system. So imagine these red buildings as being owners saying, here we have four new program requirements, planning proposals. We want you to take those programs and continue to work the design in your tool of choice, but we want you to submit it back in an open standard format that we can evaluate the designs. So yes, we do want to see the Revit models and the IFC models and everything else, but we also want to see the data from those models in a format that we can analyze, including if it's a COBE deliverable like what Tina talked about earlier. So how do owners easily consume the data if they don't know how to open Revit, for example? Revit's extremely powerful, but a lot of users would not know what to do with a Revit model. So how do you make it easy for owners to actually see data like this? There's going to be a lot more information about how this workflow happens, but just to show you quickly the other campus, this is a Mission College campus for LACCD. We were actually setting this up last night, and we had the campus in Fusion here, and we were trying to figure out where is that new building that's coming in from Panko. Is it this one right here? And then we realized, okay, it's not really here. It's actually on a satellite campus over here. So these kind of interactions allow us to quickly place the BIM that came from Panka, which is this new educational lab building, import it in and make it accessible for the teams. There was a question about how will participants be using the Gary Technologies GTX? Will it be running in the background? We're going to have a connection between the Onuma system and GTX. We're developing the instructions for that right now. This is the first connection, but for example, in the Onuma system we keep models lightweight, but if we have a full-blown Revit model that we want to see in 3D on the internet in a web browser, kind of like a mashup of the mechanical model with the architectural model, for example, GTX is going to have the ability to import that Revit or IFC model and visualize it in 3D on the web, and teams will have access to that. Okay, so that's the Mission College model. In fact, here's the model itself that came in from Revit. So you saw the Revit view of the Revit model earlier when Tina was presenting, but here is a view of what the owner might be looking at and evaluating. Do we have all the classroom space that we need? And are the spaces numbered and named the way that we want them to be able to go back into Fusion? This seems so simplistic, but this is absolutely the biggest challenge most owners have, is naming and numbering of spaces. So we have a program requirement that says we want a math classroom, and we might call it a classroom in some cases when we deliver it back as an architect. Here we want to be able to create consistency even at this room numbering and naming stage. So when we talked about standards, obviously when you're going into full-blown BIM and you're needing to share Revit with Tekla, with ArchiCAD, with Bentley, the interoperability between those tools is critical, but you're dealing with a very detailed model. It's important to have that interoperability. But here in BIMstorm, we also are focused on even the very simple stuff. If we don't have this simple interoperability, how are we going to get to the more complex connections that we need to do? And so it's kind of a hybrid approach to using these tools to be able to do this type of analysis. Okay, so we're getting close to the end. There's a couple more questions coming in if there are any last minute questions. As I said, we're going to have another webinar next week on Monday, at which we will be giving more specific instructions of how you actually get to the project data that you need. We'll be listing more information about the Kaiser projects, California Community College projects, the LACCD project, and the MiraCosta projects, and how you can jump in. We encourage teams to identify which part of the workflow, the life cycle, you're interested in. And jump into that project or that slice of the project. So we have some teams, for example, that I'm talking to right now that I'd say we're very interested in identifying how we put solar photovoltaics into a community college. That's what we're focused on, is identifying how photovoltaics would go into the community college. And so that's what this actually is. Here's the from the master plan, they've identified parking areas where photovoltaics can go in, and we have a photovoltaic array right here that has square footage. There was a question coming in, can square footage information be available at this level? And the answer is yes. This is all live data, so when you say give me a report on all the buildings on the campus, it actually generates a report of all the square footage and spaces and all the data. So here's a roll-up of the whole campus, the square footage, the value of the projects that are coming up. And as this data gets changed, the data gets updated. So this is the exciting part about BIMstorm. We want to see interaction between different teams. It's not about being isolated for a month and coming back with a result, but being able to interact with other teams that participate here. And owners want to see that interaction. They want to see us as the industry show how we collaborate and use these tools to create better value for the owners. Will there be a list of teams or individuals participating? This will be shared with, after you log in and sign up, we'll give you information of how you can connect to the other teams. We're at the last few minutes here. Do we have any final comments from the other participants in this webinar? Kaiser Permanente, any last words here? Or John or Tina, are we all okay?
I think we're okay. This is John Roach. I would like to stress again how important it is to have the standards and the data linkages. I agree wholeheartedly. The key, I've often described the space inventory that's in Fusion as the backbone of Fusion, because that's the piece that everything else can hang off of. And it's the standards approach and the keeping it simple approach that you embody in Antuma that's really making it easy for us to leverage that backbone of information.
Right. One last point here, because there was one final question. We're looking at this interface here, and the question is, are we looking at Fusion? We're looking at many things here. We're looking at Fusion data coming from the state. We're looking at Onuma system interface. We're looking at GIS data coming from the GIS server. We're looking at Google Earth backgrounds, Google Earth satellite views and maps. This is what's called a mashup. These are many tools coming together to give you kind of a common view of data coming from many sources, because as we stress on all BIMstorms, it's going to be absolutely impossible to do everything in one or two tools. If you look at the internet and the fact that iPads and smartphones are exploding, is because there's many different apps that allow you to work with a tool of your choice and keep it simple, so you're able to interact with very complex data in a simple format in real time. So we're right at the hour point here. Unless there are any final questions here, we'll be giving more details next week. Thank you all for participating. Please spread the word. We want more participation. There's a lot of people signed up already, but the more people that participate, the more interesting this becomes. And we invite you all to join in. We are looking for sponsors, so please jump in. This is completely supported by sponsors. This is not being paid for by any of these owners. These owners are all participating they're contributing their time and their information for their projects, but they are not asked to sponsor or pay for any of this. And this is really an event that we're very excited about every year and hope that we can continue on. So thank you all. We'll be logging off here right at the 1 hour mark, and we'll be posting this online in a few days and sending you all a link to the other upcoming webinars and information of how you can be part of this BIM storm. Thank you very much.